a divine accident.
This is my life. I do this.
Once a shameless, arrogant, full-time ego-driven bastard. Yeah, this guy, Mateo Mejia. I was consumed by the idea that he had to stay focused on this one thing, married to that idea. Couldn't take no for an answer. It was all about this, nothing else. And I had to look out for me. In order to build what seemed to be the only thing that's ever mattered. Regardless of when I've broken down or when I've completely lost it, I would always end up back with this thing of mine. Yeah, we made a great team. Didn't need anyone or anything else. Family and friends and all that regular life stuff, that all came after. No time to lay around, always focused, always moving, and without a care of doing anyone wrong as long as it benefited the craft.
He wanted my philosophy of life. Do it to him before he does it to you.
I did everything and anything to attempt to make the most authentic work, the most real. It didn't necessarily matter if it were bad for my health or my overall life. I never knew if this dream of mine would work, and hell, I'm still not sure it will.
You bet it's new. Cooler. Closer.
So what would you like to know? That life's panned out exactly the way I knew it would? That I'm living the dream, making more than I need? Would you like me to lie and paint a picture like everyone else? Too scared to admit how it actually is. I should have known that it would eventually catch up to me. That it wasn't sustainable to move or think like that. But what do? When you've exhausted it all, when enough is enough, and you can't seem to find that purpose anymore, to simply feel like you no longer have a place, and worst of all, you can never add a voice. not from no regular place. I come from a country where we do things differently, where belief in ourselves is incomparable to most in the States. Sure, this country isn't perfect, but it's full of some of the most driven and ambitious people you'd ever meet. My father told me the story of an unforgettable day. A day that stayed with me ever since. It was 1990 and Germany was playing against Colombia in the FIFA World Cup Italy. With only a few minutes left of the game, Barsky scored and Germany was in the lead. Only a minute left. Anyone would be discouraged to just give up. But Colombians don't work like that. They managed to get control of the ball. Carlos Valderrama pushed forward and made a pass to Freddy. And well, he. It's a part of history now, this moment. It was the first time Colombia had gotten through the first round in the World Cup. Everyone still remembers it. The footage definitely still motivates me to keep pushing it every day in hopes to make others feel something through what I do. Clearly, it never matters how much time you've run out. It's kind of how my brother and I grew up. Through our lives, we've been captivated by tales, fantasizing about becoming the characters we've witnessed in films or encountered within the pages of books, obsessed on what we would conquer, all the while diving headfirst into the unknown, oblivious to the intricate details of how it's all supposed to unfold.
I'd like to know is, where did you get the confidence from to make
ignorance.
A film with such...
Ignorance. Sheer ignorance. You know, there's no confidence to equal it. It's only when you know something about a profession, I think, that you're timid or careful.
How does ignorance show itself?
I thought you could do anything with a camera that the eye could do or the imagination could do. And if you come up from the bottom in the film business, you're taught all the things that the cameraman doesn't want to attempt for fear he will be criticized for having failed.
I've always had an issue with striving to be so perfect. Truly believe my strengths are within my imperfections. I might not be able to do it as perfect and fancy as this guy, but I know I can screw it up and make it my own thing. I'm very fond of the idea part, the story, when it comes to the craft. Not so much on how it has to be made in particular, but more so letting the idea, curiosity, and wonder drive me. Finding a camera and editing off my dad's computer was the best thing that's ever happened to me. Capturing images to stitch them together in hopes to express something meaningful and to share with others. There's nothing else like that, at least that I know of. And I wouldn't trade anything for it. I think few people understand that. Dreams matter. Ideas matter. And you gotta do what you gotta do. Whether it ruins a relationship, whether it ruins a part of your life, everything has its sacrifices, and that's what I've have realized. The question is what are you willing to sacrifice, you know? Like, what are you willing to kill in order to be able to achieve what you want in the way you want it? Is it worth it? I'm still trying to figure that out, you know. Is it worth losing certain things in your life for your art? Is it worth going through pain for your art? Which is actually a funny question, because I feel like art is very beautiful and it's a very fun process, but it's also a very painful process. It takes a lot out of you.
Nothing is so terrible as a pretentious movie. I mean, a movie that aspires for something really terrific and doesn't pull it off is shit, it's scum. And everyone will walk on it as such. And that's why poor filmmakers, in a way, that's their greatest horror, is to be pretentious. So here you are, on one hand, trying to aspire to really do something. On the other hand, you're not allowed to be pretentious. And finally you say, fuck it. I don't care if I'm pretentious or not pretentious, or if I've done it or I haven't done it. All I know is that I am going to see this movie.
Mr. Coppola always had seemed to have been right. To truly make something, I mean, to have any form of a grandiose idea, you gotta be loud and expressive with no hesitation whatsoever. People will tease you either way. They'll criticize you for doing nothing and then criticize you for doing too much of something. Not once has it ever ceased to amaze me that our love for ourselves surpasses that for others, yet we grant their opinions greater weight than our own. What does that have to do with you? Why feel guilty that you avoid certain things and people from getting in the way of your process? And I still love the people I love, even if I'm crossing the street to avoid them. And when it's clear to you for what you want, does the perception of others truly hold any significance? Maybe you like the idea of your own work lasting longer than you do. Talking passionately about your big plan. Not filtering out anything, being you and getting a kick out of pissing the pessimists off. Like, since when has that ever been wrong? To be confident in your interests. Seems like it's wrong for those who want to keep you in the same place. You'll never have every single person in your life on good terms. It's just not gonna happen. You might miss important events for the sake of staying focused on finishing something that means the world to you. If your way of creating means shutting the world out, then so be it. And there are times when you can't let anyone get to you, regardless who they are, especially family and loved ones. They can make you feel guilty for putting what you love first. Ignoring the noise is essential to getting things done. By this time, Jarrett J., incredible writer, graphic novelist, and dear friend of mine. He once told me, doing the work isn't the hard part, it's the process of tapping into it. Once you've been interrupted, it's like kicking a toy train off its tracks. I often sympathize with those my age that feel as if it's too late to build a craft in a world where things move so fast. I recently read David Lynch's book, Catching the Big Fish, and he talks about this rare divine inspiration that can just fly right in without warning. The reason you have to take advantage of it while it's here is because most of the time it just passes by. Some people call it bliss. When you make something out of it, it keeps coming. It's like you're channeling it somehow, and it just passes right through you. Musicians know it, writers know it, Robin Williams knew it. You're only given a spark of madness. If you lose that, you're nothing, Robin Williams said. You have to accept things will always change, even when you think you have gotten ahead in life, that you've figured it all out. Everything changes, even the place you used to call home. It's funny, I can talk so much about not caring what others think and how easy it is to lock into something and finish it, even though I've cared deeply my whole life. and it has been hard to focus only on what's in front of me. I'm just winging it, like nothing I do is ever truly perfect. And I'm trying to ignore about me getting old. God, I'm 25 and sometimes it can be overwhelming with the certain standard I have now towards my work. I always sadly feel like I'm not making anything that's good enough. Like the expectations feel so much higher now that I'm not as young as I used to be. I'm not really going to be cut any slack anymore, and it can be scary times. Growing up, I never knew how to put what I felt into words. When I was younger, I had been irritated for a while, but all the kids around me were actually capable of convincing me that I was worthless. They would tell me I was strange, that it was obvious that I was different, and that it wasn't cool to be around me. I legitimately felt like there had been something wrong with me. Over time, I naturally built a wall that I would hide behind within me, and it had become pretty hard to connect with anyone. Had to be some type of lone wolf, you know, like focused on the path and don't give in to so much attachment. Don't love, don't show emotion, you know, don't to be vulnerable, to allow my real self to be shown. Just always growing up thinking that I just wasn't worth it, you know. I always felt like I was not worth someone's time, and it's always kind of got into me a little bit. I'm trying to get rid of this erroneous notion of not feeling important. I've always felt like as if I needed to be something greater than myself in order to be accepted, in order to be loved. It's frightening to know that there could have been many different versions of ourselves according to who raised us, who stuck around, to the friends that left, to those who hurt you, that love you, according to what you're given, what you're fed. Thing is, we all need different patterns and combinations of influence to create a great character. You can't live a perfect life with everything handed to you. It's hard to say if it's a bad thing, and obviously it depends on so many things, mostly the way we perceive it, but by giving a perfect life, filled with no risk, no danger, no shitty friends, nothing to have learned anything from, I believe that may be worse. Cause call me out if I'm crazy, but my opinion on the point in life is to learn about yourself through your own struggles. And from my experience, that's when it stuck the best. But maybe it's also why I have so many other issues. I was picked on, got made fun of for the stuff I wanted to wear, the things I wanted to do, the person I wanted to be. I was thinking about how beautiful we were as kids, how free and innocent we were before everything else beset our inner lives. I couldn't help but wonder if the true me was still that child who never grew up. Could be why I'm always in need of time alone with my own thoughts. Children are fascinated with their everyday life. We can learn a lot from them, to be free like them. How insanely hard that's become. Remember being filled with curiosity? The feeling to be highly imaginative, how endless it felt. As you get older, you realize how much value there is within that sense of wonder. How dull adult distractions and expectations can make us. We but who you are as a child is unwanted, unwelcomed, and you're left to look for where your identity could be accepted. I ended up finding a camera and a couple of dingy friends, and soon enough all we wanted to do was make movies. Absolutely no interest in trading in our youth. I had no idea where I was running off to. I just kept telling myself, as long as you're having fun doing it, you'd most likely be alright. Knowing how lucky it was to have grown up feeling out of place. Look around you. Look at all that you've been influenced by. Just a bit of everything is necessary. Someone like Crystal, who's completely spontaneous. Or people like Sagan, that are so contagious when you catch them creating. Or like Limbo, who surprises you with his behavior. Imagine you're just tearing through the desert on a bike at 100 miles an hour, never giving a damn about the potholes, you know? That's how we wanted to live our lives, man. With the certainty that we were invincible, even if we had no clue what fate had in store for us. Breaking free from the shackles of authority, never asking for permission, taking chances, trusting ourselves, and doing what we wanted for our own growth, wherever, whenever. That's what we were all about. Or at least, that's what we agreed on at first. You see this guy? This chapter of my life was all about the itinerant lifestyle I once lived, a journey so vague and filled with detours and dead ends, one that captures the essence of a dark time in my life. Surround were marginalized young adults, all of us searching for our place in the world. We were rebels, figuratively lost in society as we struggled to find our way. Though we had followed similar paths, we were all destined to go very separate ways. I had a hard time conveying any emotions, generally kept my head down and avoided making eye contact when I spoke. Had no voice, no presence, no command. This was a period in my life when I didn't express much joy. I fell into a dangerous cycle of excessive drinking, neglecting my health, my well-being. I've never really been religious. Perhaps there could be a higher power, but maybe it lost control of its creations, or maybe it never had control to begin with.
If he doesn't change, what's going to happen? The kid has no idea. He's got bright orange hair and blue eyes. How long is he going to last in jail?
Was meek, thin, and worn down by time. A product of my environment. Following up after the shutdowns during the strangest time in my life, after being isolated for so long. I had been at the intersection of two emotions, excited for the chance to focus on different pursuits as the world hit pause, and anxious about how uncertain everything was that laid ahead. When this thing hit, it felt like the perfect excuse to disappear from everyone. To have a chance to have some breathing room to reinvent myself, to get back into the focus of my craft. I was willing and truly craving it to lock myself away for at least a year. I just needed to be my own person again. I had been around the wrong crowd for way too long. Things weren't going nowhere good.
Traveling is so expensive and difficult. It
was that innocent free spirit that I had before when I first started expressing myself. It was gone. I tried working on some projects and could barely squeeze anything out. And it's difficult when there's not much to pull from around you, and when you've given into some pretty bad habits. I'd been doom scrolling, comparing myself to the world online. I felt like I was being robbed. Attention, man, that's the currency of the day. One of the rarest and most valuable commodities. The big corporations, they're all trying to get a piece of it. And they'll do whatever it takes, spend all their cash, learning how to get in your head. They've never given a damn about us. I'm not trying to be a hypocrite. It's obvious that these platforms are valuable inventions and they have amazing uses. I obviously use them. But this stuff was at a different level during this time. We're the first humans in history to have lived the world somewhat virtually during a time where we couldn't really go outside. I don't know if that's left a mark on our psyches, but it sure changed how I saw my work and how I wanted to express myself. I mean, it set the mood. It was a dark time that I spent the majority of alone, and I was struggling with staying sober. I had to make something out of it. It's hard to explain, but time really did feel like it was just running out. Like, things really did feel like they were gonna end. It was pretty obvious there was no longer any security in the world. I don't know, I didn't really want to be thinking that negatively about everything, but it was just how my environment was at the time. I think we were just all waiting, you know, to see what was possibly next.
People, just a short time ago, as the toll of the coronavirus widens here in the U.S., the president sought to reassure the American people, saying, quote, "We are marshaling the full power of the federal government."
Can't seem to rid myself of this feeling that this could be it, that this life could be over. I've tried everything. I have my passions, what I've known to have been my purpose, but I just can't seem to find the joy in it anymore. Has my youth truly come to an end? Will I never know of that feeling of being young and free again?
I want that heart. I want the best.
It's foreign to not feel like the dreamer I've always been, filled with endless experiences and a voice to tell the tales of all that I would see. I've cried to sleep countless of times, man. Dreamt of my youth with all the ghosts and friends I'd never see again. It was pretty obvious that I was still attached to my childhood. My family, they did a remarkable job raising me. You see, they gave me the deepest kind of love that never wavers, always trusting in me and supporting me in everything I was drawn to.
Get closer, there you go.
They left it all behind, moving from a country that was nothing but dangerous at the time, just to give me a chance at a better life, so I could rise above and achieve what they never could. But sometimes I feel this fear that I won't be able to do right by them, that I'll mess it all up, and their sacrifices will have been for nothing. That's a weight, a kind of guilt, that I'm not sure I can bear. See, here's my chance.
wants to say. I'm sorry for my old ways.
I guess I have this deep-rooted fantasy that someday I'll pull myself together and not be able to take care of everyone I love. If I could choose to be here in this feeling of just not having to do much, I'd be here for the rest of my life without it being boring, with that feeling of fulfillment. I'd be perfectly fine just sitting here staring at this fire. And I would be completely fine with it.
I'm warmer on the holidays.
I still had the same goals, to make pure, genuine art, to live off of it. It's just the way that I was going about it that was finally catching up to me. Everyone who loved me dearly seemed to have begun to avoid me. Who gives a shit, they would have left anyways.
Leave like David Copperfield.
And the ones who stayed tried picking me up, or fed me their bullshit advice, which we all know is impossible to get through to someone who doesn't want to listen.
Don't you want to?
I gave people power over me, and their silence left me questioning my worth. Solitude can be a powerful muse for creation, yes, but as with all things, an excess can lead to one's undoing.
I like it how your nose is shaped. The movies don't make me afraid. Why won't they leave?
You don't always get a chance to make stuff like this. Therefore, I entertained this behavior, because I was truly inspired by it. To wake up with thoughts that linger in your mind the morning after doing something you know you shouldn't have. I've always been attracted to the self-destructive lifestyle. I had convinced myself that I needed to get completely wasted in order to create something truly meaningful. It sounds ridiculous, I know. But how do you know better when even the guys you admire did it? They were my heroes for a reason. And it's tough to let go of that mentality, even when you know it's not good for you. I didn't care about how bad I was doing, as long as I made something out of it, easily allowing myself to be swept away. Maybe I'm painting a sordid picture of my life. Could I be this ungrateful to bring up such complaints? Is this some disease I'll never be able to distinguish? Or is this a sign of the beginning of a deteriorating mind? You ever feel so alone that you start talking to the walls around you? Or so mad that they seem to speak back. I'd unintentionally created pure misery, a mind only filled with hysteria. I'd misplaced my truths, only to discover that I've murdered the wrong man. I was in no condition to make real choices, nor to think appropriately about my current life situations. So I took the time to get completely clean. I really pushed myself to do this. It was months of repetitive, fully intentional work, lots and lots of time to myself to just think. To think about where I was taking this story, what is it that actually makes me happy, and what I've wanted in my life as opposed to what I've thought I've wanted.
I'd been searching for an answer to why I haven't been happy. I mean, I have everything in my life that, I mean, you would say would make an individual happy. I think what I've wanted my entire life was routine and control, and I guess mostly control. But when you're someone who makes things and you set your own, you know, your own plan, and you don't really have much of that, any of that, to be honest with you. There may not be a blueprint or anything to really be able to keep me looking forward to the future. I guess it kind of just, the more you do this, it kind of just paves itself. And I guess that's what it is, you know. I think this answer that I have right now, I mean, it's going to evolve, and my answer today may not be my answer tomorrow.
My definition of a film director is the man who presides over action.
I had to get back to my roots to figure out why I started this in the first place. It had nothing to do with wealth. It had nothing to do with status. I was stuck on the trajectory of the story. I hadn't really found the real solution yet. I was left creatively stifled. I was completely blocked. Nothing made sense anymore. My father had been working on this painting. I was observing him go from scratch to finish, and it reminded me of whenever I first fell in love with just being in my room by myself, creating. You see, I've been treating art as if it were a means to an end. It always needed to be justified or have some form of intent. In doing so, I had set too many limitations, hindering the beauty of divine accidents. The simple sheer pleasure of creating was the true essence, not the eventual outcome. That's what made it genuinely special. Having no control, just full commitment, persistently driven by no one but oneself, and the rest will follow.
Side by side.
convince you you're not good at what you do. I know I once did. Important thing that I want to achieve is just freedom to create whatever it is that I want to, freedom to live the way I want to, and to be able to provide for the ones I love using that. Just thinking about the process, you know, like, you have to put in a lot of time by yourself and you have to sacrifice a lot, you know, for it. And I'm in the point in my life where it's a little difficult now to really figure out what it is that I wanted to sacrifice for this. There's certain things that make me so happy, certain people, that I don't know if it's worth sacrificing and burning a bridge for those people I love, in order to just be great. I know it's ingrained in our human species to leave a footprint on this planet. And I do want to be remembered, and I do want to have legacy and whatnot, but at the same time, what does that actually mean? What is that? What's that for? If I'm not even going to be here to be able to enjoy it. Understand that faith is something completely separate from mere speculation, and that true beauty went far beyond mere physical appearance. Yes, I was driven by a desire to discover all that the world had to offer. If there's anything I've gained from writing this story, it would be that whether young or old, rich or poor, it matters not what status or profession we hold. At the end of it all, it is not our material possessions or accomplishments that define us, but the love and passion we hold within our hearts and the connections we've made with those around us. For in this brief and fleeting existence, it is the time we spend with loved ones that truly holds the greatest value. So let us cherish those moments and hold them dear, for in the grand scheme of things, they are truly all that's ever mattered.
I got my cigarette, dog.
Yeah, there you go.